God, my Father, there is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not, Thy compassions, they fail not. As Thou hast been, Thou forever will be. Great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness, morning by morning new mercies I see, and all I have needed Thy hands hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto sin and a peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 besides. Faithfulness, Lord, every morning new mercies I see, and all I have needed Thy hands have provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy.
Offerings that you have contributed and continue to mail in. We're so grateful for that. We also want to thank those of you who are coming to the drive-in church. You can do both. You don't have to limit yourself. You have two, and I know some of you have been doing both. So thank you for your faithfulness. And we know that it's hard for us to be apart like this. We're so grateful that we have this opportunity to be together. We also thank David and Craig and Jenny, as we always do, for everything they do to make this service possible. We are filming and doing a parking lot service at 9 a.m. Sunday, June 28th. July 12th. And we thank those with the technical skills, like Phil and Chris, that make the parking lot service possible.
Thank you. And also, I just want to tell you, I was raised in a church where we went to church on Sunday morning for a service, and then we went back to church Sunday evening for a second service. So guess what, folks? You have that chance now for worshiping twice. You can watch the Sunday, so come here for the parking lot service on Sunday morning. You can listen to it. Some of you are close by, maybe you'll catch it on the FM radio dial, 107.7 on your radio dial. We'll be doing the same readings and usually the same sermon, but it's a different liturgy and it's a different setting. And I think that it doesn't hurt to hear the gospel twice in one day. So you can do the parking lot service in the morning, either live here or for some of you close by, you may be able to catch it on your radio dial, and then you can do this service on Sunday evenings. Wow! Doing something retro here, folks. Our intro for today, for July 12th, the sixth Sunday after Pentecost. God's work is like the rains that water the earth and bring forth vegetation. It is like the sower who sows seed indiscriminately. Our lives are like seeds sown in the earth. Even from what appears to be little, dormant, or dead, God promises a harvest. At the Lord's table, we are fed with the bread of life, that we may bear fruit in the world. Today I'd like to bring out two commemorations. First, today on Sunday the 12th, the church remembers Nathan Sonnenblom. Nathan Sonnenblom was the Bishop of Uppsala in Sweden, and he won a Nobel Prize for his efforts to unite peoples after the First World War. And Sonnenblom was instrumental in getting the World Council of Churches together. So the church remembers the work, the life, the witness of Nathan Sonnenblom this day. And then another of my personal favorites is this Friday, the 17th of July, the church remembers Bartolome de las Casas. Bartolome de las Casas, Bartholomew of the houses. He was a missionary in the Indians. He started as a soldier. He was given a vast estate for his service in the Spanish army, but then he became a priest. He freed his slaves, his Indian slaves that had been given him for his service in the army. And he worked throughout Latin America, throughout Central America and the Caribbean to improve the life and the lot of Native Americans. So this Sunday, today, July 12th, Nathan Sonnenblom, Bishop of Uppsala, and then on Friday the 17th, Bartolome de las Casas, missionary to the Indies. Amen.
Oh, yeah. Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for planting in us the seed of your word. By your Holy Spirit, help us to receive it with joy, live according to it, and grow in faith and hope and love. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Amen. The first reading is taken from Isaiah 55, 10 through 13. God's word to Israel's exiles is as sure and effective as never-failing precipitation. Their return to the Holy Land in a new exodus is cheered on by singing mountains and by trees that clap their hands. The reading. For as the rain and snow come down from heaven and do not return there until they have watered the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose and succeed in the thing for which I sent it. For you shall go out in joy and be led back in peace. The mountains and the hills before you shall burst into song, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress, instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle. And it shall be to the Lord for a memorial, for an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off.
Amen. And the psalm for today is Psalm 65. In the psalm, there's this theme of abundance, superabundance. We're not reading the whole psalm today, just the last half. But we hear of God's bounty and God's glory. We hear of God's bounty upon the earth. Your paths overflow with plenty. You visit the earth and water it abundantly. You make it very plenteous. The river of God is full of water. You prepare the grain, for so you provide for the earth.
You drench the furrows and smooth out the ridges. With heavy rain, you soften the ground and bless its increase.
You crown the year with your goodness, and your pathways overflow with plenty.
May the fields of the wilderness be rich for grazing, and the hills be clothed with joy.
May the meadows cover themselves with flocks, and the valleys clothe themselves with grain. Let them shout for joy and sing.
The second reading this morning is taken from Romans 1 through 11.
There is no condemnation for those who live in Christ. God sent Christ to accomplish what the law was unable to do, condemn sin and free us from its death-dealing ways. The Spirit now empowers proper actions and values in our lives and gives us the promise of resurrected life. There is, therefore, now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do, by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh. To deal with sin, he condemned sin in the flesh, so that the just requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For this reason, the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, indeed it cannot. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh. You are in the Spirit, since the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit in him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit that dwells in you. Amen.
The Holy Gospel for today is from Matthew chapter 13. In Matthew's Gospel, both Jesus and his disciples sow the seed of God's word by proclaiming the good news that the kingdom of heaven is near. Now, in a memorable parable, Jesus explains why this good news produces different results in those who hear. The Holy Gospel according to Matthew chapter 13. Glory to you, O Lord. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the sea. Such a great crowd gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat there, while the whole crowd stood on the beach. And he told them many things in parables, saying, "Listen, a sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seed fell on the path, and birds came and ate them up. Other seeds fell on rocky ground that did not have much soil, and they sprang up quickly because they had no depths of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no roots, they withered away. Other seeds fell among the thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them out. And other seed fell on good soil and brought forth grain, some 100-fold, some 60, and some 30. Let anyone who has ears listen." Hear the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in the heart. This is like what is sown on the path. So for what was sown on the rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet such a person has no root, but endures only for a little while. And trouble or persecution arises on account of the word, that person immediately falls away. So that what was sown among the thorns is that one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the lures of wealth choke the word, and it yields. Nothing. But as for what is sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields it in one case 100-fold, another 60, and another 30. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
Help us, O Lord, to be masters of ourselves, that we may be the servants of others. Take our lips and speak through them. Take our minds and think through them. Take our hearts and set them on fire. Wow, the sower, and I think when we hear the word sower, perhaps you think of a needle and thread, sewing, like this, but in the gospel here, it's in this particular reading, is a different kind of sewing, and it reminds me of when I was a little boy. My parents bought a new farm, a new for us, and Dad had sowed oats to produce a harvest for that year, and then he sowed Timothy seed, which would produce a harvest for the following years. And there was a little bit of seed left over, so Dad emptied the sower, and we filled up bags, and Dad, myself, a little guy, and my sister Joy had her own bags, and we followed just scattering the leftover seed upon the field. And, for planting in our beautiful garden that we have here at Cedar Church, you open the ground and put a seed in. But the sowing, or sometimes it's called broadcasting, you take a handful of the seed, the small seed, and the Timothy seed is very small, take a seed, and some of the seed will come out, But Dad showed us, you know, you wave your hand, and then you open one finger, and then spread your arm, open the next finger, and spread the seed as you keep walking forward, and open the third finger and the fourth finger, and then you slap off any seed that's stuck to you, the sweat of your hand or the oil of your hand. And that's broadcasting or sowing the seed. And this reference that we have in today's reading from the Gospel of Matthew, which is also in the Gospel of Mark, which is also in the Gospel of Luke, the exact same parable and the exact same explanation, is it has envisioned that kind of seeing, of broadcasting, of opening up a finger and letting the seed come out, opening up a finger and letting the seed come out, and the soil is spread out on here, on the soil before us. It's coming to us as our sowing season, our planting season is pretty well wrapped up here in Pennsylvania. But we have this reading, and if you continue in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 13, we go right into another story about sowing seed. Now, there's definitely four different types of services, environments for the seed. There's that hard path, and that seed's just not going to have a chance to germinate and put sprout roots into the soil, that hard path. And they're a perfect target for birds to come and eat. And then if you've ever planted plants in a small pot, there's not enough soil, the plant will grow because there's no energy going into the production of roots. And so a plant will grow, and if there's a lot of stones, the top part will grow quite rapidly, impressively, but there's no depth in the seeds, in the roots. And so the plant can't survive a scorching sun. And those thistles, we have some beautiful thistles here in Pennsylvania. There's this beautiful purple one that's about half the size of my fist. Did you see it once when I sat on the roadside? I want to stop and cut it. They're so beautiful now as an adult, but as a child, they were so unpleasant to walk beside. And my eyes are gazing across this room as if you're sitting in your respective pews. And I'll focus down here on Craig and the camera. But I'd say perhaps there's some of the hard soil in each of us. There's some of the soil, stony soil in each of us. There's some of that thorns that crowd around us and try to choke the life out of us and all of us. And I'd say there's a lot of good soil in each of us as well. A lot of good soil. In regards to that hard packed soil, I'd say don't let evil take away your joy in the gospel. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. We often sing that as an offertory in church on Sunday mornings. But don't let evil take away your joy in the gospel. That's like, don't let that hard soil be the predominant soil in your life. And then in regards to that stony soil where there's no depth of roots, I'd say don't let worries test you. Don't let testing cause you to waver in your faith. And don't let the meanness of spiritual bullies, take away your joy in the gospel. And then in regards to that, those thorns, they can be beautiful in Pennsylvania, those beautiful purple flowers, but they ultimately will choke you and scratch it. Don't let worry and the love of wealth take away your joy in the gospel. Don't let worry and your fear about what you don't have take away your joy in the gospel. And then let the seed be falling into good soil. Let the joy of the gospel grow in your hearts and in your minds. Let the joy of the gospel grow in your hearts and minds. I've never been in a church that had a garden on the property. And last year I helped with the planting. I was around, but this year kind of got planted and I didn't even know about this happening. So we have this wonderful example of planting and growing right here on this campus. I'd like to close with this poem. Everything has its season. In order for new growth, one day the beauty will be seen from the seeds that God has sown. For our lives are like a garden, the planting of the Lord. Sun and rain combine to make a bountiful reward. For seeds need God's nature in order to produce a beautiful, fragrant garden ready for the kingdom's use. At times, God needs to weed out ungodly things in us so nothing will come to threat the sowing within He does. So we grow to our potential in what garden will grow into our potential in what God has given us. We will be more effective in the spreading of His love. As we spread the seed of His love to others, may we reap a mighty harvest of souls for Jesus Christ. Our lives forever changed from what it was before, the beauty produced in our lives as a reflection of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Hallelujah. And amen.
Creating God, the mountains and hills burst into song, and the trees and fields clap their hands in praise. We pray for the birds and the animals who make their home in the trees, for lands stripped bare by deforestation. Empower us to sustainably use what you have given. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great.
Reigning God, we pray for our nation's leaders. Increase their desire for justice and equality. We pray for our enemies. Bridge the chasms that divide us and guide authorities to a deep and lasting peace. We pray for those for whom living in this time of COVID-19 virus has been and is especially difficult or even painful and sad. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great.
Abiding God, care for all who are in need, especially Lorraine, Donald, Charlie, Harper, Anna Mae, Anna, Nevin, Marlene, RJ, Hazley, Marcella, Joanne, Nancy, Beth, Lois, Maggie, Ardella, Martha, Jeff, Joanna Maurice, Scott, Pat, Janine, Myra, Julie, Alan, Marge, Carol, Brenda and her family, Anne, Brooke, John, Brenda, Lucy, Cassie, Mabel, Kenny, and Sarah. For those who are doubting, renew faith. For those who are worrying, provide release. For those who are struggling, ease burdens. For those in fear, give hope. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great.
Renewing God, revive your church in this place. Nourish and nurture the seeds you have planted, that we might grow as disciples. Replace what has been depleted. Restore our ministries and deepen relationships with the wider community. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great.
Merciful God, our ordinary gifts seem small for such a celebration, but you make of them an abundance, just as you do with our lives. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great.
Eternal God, we give thanks for all who have died, especially Nathan Sodenblom, Bishop of Uppsala, Sweden, whom we commemorate today. Comfort us in the sure and certain hope of the resurrection. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great.
Receive these prayers, O God, and those too deep for words, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
May the one who brought forth Jesus from the dead raise you to new life, fill you with hope, and turn your mourning into dancing. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen. Amen. Thanks be to God.